thank you for coming again. We have two amazing speakers for you, Dan and Boris from United Cloud. Yeah, the stage is guys.
So, hello everybody, my name is Dan. So today we were gonna walk you through the lifetime of one of EON TV's features that we've developed, our architecture decisions that we made along the way, and through some obstacles, through some challenges that we needed to overcome in order to have our production running as fast as overcaffeinated teenager. So today we will also walk you through some infrastructure improvements that we made in order for our future to work better and more closer to the clients, and in order for our complete EON TV platform to work more performant. So TV 2.0 represents the biggest product line at United Cloud, commonly known under an EON TV brand. So EON TV represents a video streaming platform that is digitally distributing the television content as a streaming media to the end users. So on our EON TV platform, we have a bunch of services. We have streamers, encoders, a bunch of stuff that are doing the magic to deliver the stream to our end users. That streaming media represents in the terms of EON TV channels and video on demand content. So for the purpose of this presentation, we'll focus more on more challenging part, meaning channels. On EON TV, you have channels as a streaming media, but as a user, you can press the button on your remote controller, you can watch your television content, but as you know, as we're living in these times, you certainly cannot dedicate that much time to watch your television content at the moment as it is happening in live. So you need to have a possibility to watch it in some moment that it happened in the past. So during that user experience, you probably felt the need to have some handy feature that allows you to specifically visually know where you at the moment of rewinding or forwarding your channel. So that functionality in EON TV we call fast forward and rewind functionality. In order to implement this feature, we needed to develop a group of services that are performing real-time streaming processing. So real-time streaming processing term is used to describe streams of real data that are being gathered and processed as they are generated. So in the terms of this functionality, we have channel streams, live streams that are streams that are endless and that needs to be continuously processed. So it would be much easier if we can work with some files that have their duration or static files, videos, TV shows, but for the live streams that are endless, it's a bit more tricky. So we have channel streams, we have streams of real data. What kind of processing do we have here? So one of key points of this feature was to be a keyframe accurate. What does that mean? It means that for end user, we want to be able to deliver them the possibility to start the playback of their favorite TV show just from the moment that it is presented on the image preview that we create. So our algorithm basically is parsing the stream continuously, detecting the keyframe, and extract an image from it. So what exactly is the keyframe? So every video is consistent from parts called fragments, and each fragment is consistent from images called frames. So keyframe represents a frame or frame that stores all the data needed for that image to be previewed. So after a bit of introduction to this functionality, let's say a few words regarding our architecture. So as you can see on this image, we have some cubes landing down to the orchestrator component. So as the name is self-explanatory, we had a need to have a bit of centralized approach here. So we wanted to have a component that has a responsibility to manage and to coordinate communication between extractor and stitcher microservices, between other microservices in this group of services. Extractor service responsibility is to extract keyframe from a stream, extract individual image, and store it on the shared storage, while stitcher microservice responsibility is to stitch all the images extracted for that 1 minute and store it onto the storage. Above the storage, we have an Nginx that is used for serving files to the end users. So, as you know, you can do performance testing, you can do various of tests on your test environments, but sometimes you need to make some decisions, architecture decisions, with thoughts that it will bring you the best results. One of those decisions for us was to go with Sprite, full managed image, that is Stitcher's responsibility. We wanted initially to reduce the load on our servers to have just one call per minute per channel from client side, not to have 10 to 15 calls to our servers to fetch the resources. So Stitcher delivers the Sprite, full minute image, and it delivers the index file, which describes the position of each and individual image inside of that Sprite. So on the client side, client applications can interpolate that Sprite, or they can do whatever mathematics they want to do with it. After a story about the architecture, we wanted to decide about the deployment procedure. So RAM memory is the most challenging part at the world of real-time streaming processing. So it is tough to find the proper architecture that serves and the deployment procedure that serves to the group of services that are performing real-time streaming processing. What is the computing power that we want to have? Is it going to be one instance doing it all? Certainly not. We want to divide we want to minimize our risks. We want to reduce the blast radius of our microservices. So, yes, we have used Kubernetes to deploy this group of services, and we heavily use some Kubernetes functionalities that allows you out of the box to do certain things. So we've decided to go with a configuration of 10 channels per instance that can be processed in parallel. And we have used Kubernetes functionalities to limit the RAM memory, CPU, and to minimize the affectation of one channel processing failure to all the other channel processing failures. Currently, we have over 1,000 of channels on our production. So that means that we have currently more than 200 instances working 24/7 and processing endlessly and continuously channel streams. Besides that functionality, we also heavily use the possibility that Kubernetes allows you to easily scale your services, so even in runtime. So when a new channel arrives, orchestrator components looks into its own DB and it checks if there is existing instance that can process new channel. If there is not such one, orchestrator communicates directly to the Kubernetes cluster and scales a new exeter and stitcher instances that starts doing its magic. So after all of this, it comes some implementation, running our test environments, and the time came to roll out this feature on a production. So first step there is let the backend work. So EON TV platform enables you to watch your television content for 7 days in the past. That is our catch-up TV policy. So we need to let our backend work for 7 days to prepare all the images when user performs rewinding to have the images. So we have our more than 200 instances working 24/7, and we came to conclusion by monitoring our system that we have on a daily level that we are re-extracting 16 million of images, and that we stitch 16 million of images around 1.6 million of sprites daily, along with 1.6 million of index files. So we needed to have some thresholds on our backend side that are telling us whether we are doing it fine or not. One of those thresholds is to have that 1 minute image or sprite consisted from at least 12 individual images. So we are controlling the fragment size. We have it on 4.8 seconds. And we know that we have minimum of 12 individual images that we need to extract. So by looking into our Grafana, we can see that our backend components working fine. The next phase is server-side caching. So besides those thresholds that already mentioned, we had some acceptance criteria, of course, to fulfill. One of those acceptance criteria was to have our resources fetched to our clients under 100 milliseconds, so the user experience is good. So our colleagues from the DevOps team helped us to set up some Nginx content cache rules and to cache every successful response. That means that when some user wants to fetch a sprite for some minute, it gets cached on the Nginx level, so the next user that wants to fetch the same sprite, it will be served from an Nginx, not going through our images origin to our storage servers. So that means that we are faster to the clients, but we also reduce the load on our servers. Last phase is, of course, let the clients call fast forward and rewind engine. We monitor it. We say, and okay, we can say that we are fine. Response times are good. We are fulfilling the thresholds of 100 milliseconds. What kind of flow do we have on our server? So we can see on this Grafana dashboards that we have some peak times. It is understandable. Majority of people watch the television content from 8 to 11 p.m. So we can see that we have like 7,000 of requests per second for fast forward and rewind resources in a peak time. But we can also see that we have some green line here that is telling us that we have 4 cases of requests per second that are successful. But we have around 3,000 requests per second that are 404. So how did this happen? We did some analyzing part and we concluded the next thing. So on the image below, you can see the timeline. So you have last minute and you have live minute that is going continuously. So considering the fact that we still want 1 minute image sprite, our stitcher needs to wait until the live minute to finish in order to stitch the sprite. So if stitcher stitches a sprite in, for example, 50th millisecond of a live minute and client request comes in 49th millisecond of a live minute, we have a 404. So what now? Users see black images, or they don't see them, they don't have them. We have 404s for live and last minute, and we have increased load on our origin servers, meaning 3,000 of requests per second in our peak time going through our storage servers, through our images origin, not being served from the Nginx level. So the decision at that point of time was easy. We need to protect our servers. We just excluded calls for that 2 minutes from our client side. And yes, we have fixed 404s, we don't have it anymore. But 2 days after, of course, we have a P0. Our operators are boomed with the calls from the users complaining that they don't have images, especially for television posushi. You cannot imagine how much people watch television posushi. So time came to caffeine ourselves, to think of the solution. We need to fix the P0 ASAP. And we concluded that we need to change our stitching algorithm. We still want to have the 1 minute image, but we don't want to have it stitched at the end of the minute. We want to stitch it continuously in runtime when each individual image gets extracted. We need to concatenate the sprite. So we did it. Caching stays the same. We still want to offload our servers. We want to be fast. And P0 is solved. Everything is fine, but not so good. Damn, it's still not good. We have another problem here on the production. We have now a situation when we have incomplete cached live minute sprites. How did this happen? So basically, when Stitcher now in runtime concatenates the sprite, and in 20th second of a minute, he stitches a sprite consistent from 3 images, and the user wants to fetch that resource, and he gets the resource successfully, but we cache it, it's 2x6. So if any other user in any other point of future wants to fetch the same resource, he will get the incomplete sprite, no matter if Stitcher stitched it completely during the time. So the time came to deal with server-side caching. On the next image, we present you some simplified version of our infrastructure around this feature. So we have clients calling for fast forwarding and rewind resources. Client requests comes to the Nginx setup on our edge locations that are more closest to the clients. Request is being forwarded to the origin Nginx setup above our origin servers. So we needed a way to tell to the Nginx how to cache the sprite based on the time that it is requested from. So if it belongs to the live minute, cache it that way. If it belongs to some moment in the past, cache it for 7 days as the EON TV policy. But we couldn't do it by using Nginx due to the complexity, due to the performances. But we still wanted to use the benefits of Nginx as until now. So our solution leads down to the OpenResty. So OpenResty represents a fork of Nginx. It is basically a web platform that has its own enhanced version of Nginx alongside with the Lua just-in-time compiler. So that's everything what we need. Lua runs directly on Nginx workers, and it's known as immensely fast when using with Lua JIT. So we are developers, let's write some Lua scripts that will evaluate every request and set adequate response headers. So first thing that we need to do is to switch our infrastructure part. So we switched our Nginx setup on our edge and origin locations, and we set up OpenResty, and we hosted our Lua scripts there. So when our images origin return a resource to the origin OpenResty, Lua script gets evaluated and it sets adequate response header. which says, okay, if the sprite fetched for that minute belongs to the live minute, cache it for 4 seconds. If it's not, cache it for 7 days. But while we are here, why not to play a bit with client-side caching as well? So on the edge level, Nginx inside of the OpenRST caches the resource based on accordingly to this header that was set up in the previous step. And it sets also a cache control header, no cache, no store, for the sprites that are belonging that belong to the live minute. So the client gets its own resources, and the client applications can cache that resource based on that response header. So I mentioned previously that yes, we had some architecture decisions that affected our development phase and even running in production phase. Does it represent a premature optimization or the best design? We kind of don't know an answer on it. We certainly know that the users of television posters have been taken care of, but we certainly know that it brought us some performance gain. We don't have 10 to 15 requests per minute per channel. We have only one request, but it certainly brought us some challenges that we need to overcome. We need to change our backend implementation. We needed to enhance the caching rules. We need to change even our infrastructure part. So the decision is up to all of us here. So I will let Boris now to inform you more regarding the infrastructure improvements that we made in order for this feature to work faster and to be more closer to the clients, and the various other infrastructure improvements that we made in general to make our complete EON TV platform work more performant. So, Boris.
Thank you. So, as Dejan just said, we'll now dig a bit deeper into the stack and we'll find out what's happening beneath services like Fast Forward Rewind. So we'll talk more about infrastructure that powers Fast Forward Rewind and other services that we are developing in United Cloud as well. So I will start this talk with, since I'm SRE in United Cloud, Site Reliability Engineer, so infrastructure team, I will start this talk from infrastructure team point of view. So what we have? We have services. As you could see, some of them are Kubernetes native, so they're using some Kubernetes features to work. They're utilizing Kubernetes features. Some of them are microservices. Some of them are services that are following microservice design patterns, which is totally fine. On the other side, we have our infrastructure, and here you probably already could smell the challenges that we have. Our infrastructure is on-premises infrastructure, so that basically means a bunch of physical servers that are geographically distributed literally all around the globe. And together we have one common goal, and that is to provide low latency content delivery, as you could see from Fast Forward Rewind example, to provide highly available infrastructure, to provide secure infrastructure, and to and our infrastructure should be decentralized. So ideally, we should not have like single point of failures in entire stack. Okay, so our infrastructure is basically divided into two parts. So we have stateful and stateless part. Dan was talking a bit about this. So our stateful and stateless, or core and edge parts, how we call it internally, are basically, so stateful part is the part of infrastructure where we are hosting services like databases, storage servers, and services that do generate some kind of content like Fast Forward Rewind engine. And our stateful infrastructure lives in private network, so you as end user will never reach directly our core or stateful part of infrastructure. What you will reach is our stateless or our edge locations, which are geographically distributed. And on our edge, we are hosting services that that actually serves the end user requests. And they are acting as caching layers, as you already could see from Fast Forward Rewind example. And on our edge, we have a lot of services, and our edge is pretty dynamic in terms of updating those services. And interesting thing is that On our core location, we have some Kubernetes clusters and some bare metal machines. So on Kubernetes clusters, we are hosting services like Fast Forward Rewind. On bare metal machines, we are hosting databases, message brokers. We didn't migrate them to Kubernetes yet. But on our edge locations, where we are hosting all those services, we are currently running Ubuntu, which is run on some bare metal machines. So this was totally fine. So this design was set up like 6-7 years ago when we were starting with EON. We had literally two services, two Java-based services that were running on those servers. But now the situation is a bit different. Now we have to host like more than 30 services and microservices on our edge locations. So running them on Ubuntu is definitely not the best thing you can do. So what we want to do is we want to basically push Kubernetes to our edge locations. So this is totally fine. So why don't we just upgrade our infrastructure to Kubernetes? That should not be a big deal. Well, the main reason is that if we do that, workloads that are running on different edge locations, meaning in different Kubernetes clusters, because we don't want to have like shared or distributed Kubernetes cluster. So all workloads that are running on different Kubernetes cluster would not be able to communicate with each other. So why is this important for us? That cross cluster, cross location communication. Why is it important for us? Well, we said that our infrastructure should be highly available. That means if some request lands on one edge location, and on that location or in that Kubernetes cluster, we don't have healthy endpoints for that specific to process that specific request, we want our load balancer or ingress controllers or whatever accepted that request. We want from that component to be able to proxy basically that request to other to a healthy component of that service on other location. Why is this not impossible? Well, that's basically how Kubernetes works. So in Kubernetes cluster, entire Kubernetes cluster has to share some L2, some private network. So pod to pod, well, workload to workload communication in same Kubernetes cluster always works, but cross cluster communication by default does not work. So this is the biggest challenge. It's definitely not unsolvable. There are different solutions to provide that basic connectivity between different clusters, but we decided to go with Cilium. So currently we have more than 30 clusters, and all of them are running Cilium, and some of them are using Cilium cluster mesh and other features. I will be talking about this today. So what is Cilium? Cilium is, at its core, Cilium is just basic Kubernetes CNI plugin, but in reality, it's actually much more than that. So it's actually only CNCF graduated CNI plugin, so we are kind of sure that we'll stay here for a while. It's eBPF based. So what is eBPF? So eBPF is basically a Linux technology that allows you to run arbitrary eBPF programs into the kernel. So with eBPF programs, you can change basically the kernel behavior in a runtime, and you can share some information from the kernel to the user space application. There was a talk keeping up with Keycloak. They showed the Pyroscope graph. So they used Pyroscope tool to profile their application. So, for example, Pyroscope is using eBPF capabilities to do all the CPU tracing. We will see later in presentation how Cilium is using eBPF. And because it's eBPF based, it allows Cilium to be a sidecar-less service mesh. So we have service mesh features without sidecars in all our pods that are part of that service mesh. And why we love Cilium, and we do love Cilium, is because it's cluster mesh, service mesh features, because transparent encryption, observability, state-of-the-art performance, and Cilium network policies. Okay, so with cluster mesh, we get something like this. So when you join multiple clusters in Cilium cluster mesh, what's happening under the hood is Cilium is basically extending that private Kubernetes network across multiple, across all clusters that are part in a service mesh. And if we enable, when we join like multiple clusters in cluster mesh, at, from that point, all pods that are running in all clusters that are part of same cluster mesh can basically talk to each other like they are in same cluster. So if pod from one cluster wants to access the service in other cluster, it can use like same domain name, same service name, like it's like it has like local endpoints. But we need the security on top of that. For that, we can enable a Cilium transparent encryption feature. When Cilium transparent encryption is enabled, basically all the communication going from one Kubernetes node, so from pod running on one Kubernetes node to pod running on other Kubernetes node, which is part of cluster mesh, no matter if it's in same cluster or in different cluster in cluster mesh, all that communication will go through VPN tunnels. We can use WireGuard or IPsec VPN tunnels, so we are sure that all inter-cluster, inter-service communication in single cluster is encrypted, and it's really transparent. Additionally, with the Cilium service mesh, we can add additional layer of security. We can use Cilium mutual authentication feature. So it's basically if you're using the other service mesh implementation, it's basically the same thing as MTLS, but it's a bit differently implemented in Cilium. So it has different name, but it serves the same purpose. So if we opt to secure some our endpoint with mutual authentication, all peers that want to talk to that specific endpoint have to submit TLS certificate to prove their identity. And the best thing here is that almost all of these features are transparent. They are not just transparent to services that are running in those Kubernetes clusters. They are actually transparent to developers that are deploying their stuff to Kubernetes cluster. And the craziest thing is that they are mostly transparent to us as operators of those Kubernetes clusters. Okay. We will have the Cilium observability demo, but before we jump into the demo, I want to share some details about environment for that demo. So we have two Kubernetes clusters which are part of same service mesh. It's Cilium, and we have Cilium demo namespace in both Kubernetes clusters, and we have these Cilium network policies applied in both clusters. So if you are familiar with Kubernetes and Kubernetes network policies, Cilium network policies are basically serving the same purpose, but they are much more powerful. So as you can see here, with Cilium network policies, we can use L7 rules. So Cilium network policies are protocol aware, L7 protocol aware, so we can create a policy which says, which allows, for example, all pods from Cilium demo namespace to talk to Cilium demo application pod on port 8000 and to do only the HTTP GET request on /hostname endpoint, which is a crazy thing. Also, beside HTTP rules, we can create DNS rules, DNS aware rules. So we can say, for example, this second rule, it allows all pods from Cilium demo namespace to talk to all endpoints inside Kubernetes clusters. But it additionally allows all pods from, again, same namespace to talk to api.ipbase.com on port 443. So that's some external resources. And the third policy is another egress policy. So we are allowing all pods to talk to Kube DNS, so it can resolve actually that domain. Okay, it's demo time now. What we have here is on the left side of the screen we have a Cilium Hubble UI. So it's a Cilium observability component. And it currently shows nothing because we didn't generate any load yet. And on the right side of the screen, we have two Kubernetes clusters, blue and green Kubernetes clusters, opened in K9S. So I don't know if you guys see this, but here we can see that in a green cluster, in both clusters we have Cilium Dem application service, but in one cluster, in green cluster, we actually have some local endpoints for that service, that's green cluster, and in blue cluster, as you can see above, we don't have local endpoints for that service. And if you try to, from that same namespace, if you try to from the cluster that has local endpoints, if you try to access our service on /hostname endpoint, we will see in this Hubble service map that toolbox pod, which is pod we are using for testing, for generating the load in this demo, some toolbox pod talked to Cilium demo application pod. It talked to port 8000. It was TCP HTTP connection, which is great. But the thing which is like also great is that here we can actually see that it did GET request on /hostname endpoint, and because our service is ultra performant, it responded for 0 milliseconds. So yeah, and it returned like hostname of the pod. Okay, so if you try to do the same thing from other namespace that does not have local endpoints, we'll see basically the same thing, but we'll have like additional card. And I don't know, I will zoom in here. And we can see the additional metadata here. So we know that this one card is for toolbox pod in one cluster, and another card is toolbox pod in another cluster. So now I will try to resolve google.com domain. So I got response because my pod can talk to kubedns server, which is great. And we can see that communication in Hubble. We just have to enable DNS communication, and if we just enable it, we would see that our toolbox pod was talking to kubedns. Great. Now I will talk to issue the HTTP request to google.com, and nothing will happen. Why? Because I didn't allow my pods to talk to google.com, because why would we? They already know what we are doing, so no reason to help them. And we see that these requests to google.com are dropped by our policies. Cool. So since we don't have much time, now I will try to access api.ipbase.com, and that request will be forwarded. And of course, we see that here in Hubble UI. The thing which is important to mention is that by default, well, not by default, but open source Cilium and Hubble. In open source Cilium and Hubble, we don't have any data persistence inside the Hubble, but Hubble is exposing all those metrics that you just seen on this screen. It exposes them in Prometheus format, so Prometheus can scrape those metrics with all the metadata we just saw in this demo. So what now we can do is another crazy thing. We can literally create the Grafana dashboard, which is, and we can for example create dashboard which can answer the question what this pod is talking with, so with which endpoint. So for example, here I've selected my toolbox pod, and here I can select its peer, so api.ipbase.com. So basically we can visualize communication between pods that are running inside some Kubernetes cluster, and we can visualize communication with which is outside of our cluster. So when our pods talk with some external resources. 1 minute. Okay, I will be fast. Okay, so this last but not least thing. We'll be talking a bit about Cilium performance. So here, so what we did? We did a benchmark. So we had Kubernetes ingress, Nginx ingress running in one on one Kubernetes node that has to proxy. Then, so we have Kubernetes ingress on one node, and we have some Nginx pod which generates some content. So when client request comes to that ingress, it should proxy that request to that pod, and it should return response to the client. So we generated, so this is set up with Kubernetes and kubeproxy and Weave. This is set up we used at the beginning. So we see that we are generating around 10 to 15,000 of requests per second, which is not good, not bad. We do see some response time distribution here, but the bad thing is that at that scale, we are hitting our CPU to 100%. So basically, we are exhausting our CPU. With Cilium, when we run our Kubernetes clusters with Cilium deployed in Cilium native routing mode, we can see that now we can serve sustained 30,000 requests per second. We have much better response time distribution, and the best thing is that now we have our CPU utilization is just under 40%. It's around 30%. So if we want to, what this basically allows us is to deploy services like that OpenResty on top of Kubernetes in our edge locations, and we are kind of sure that we can achieve the sub 100 millisecond latency, which is basically part of our product. So with that said, I would like to thank you all for being here today with us. We don't have time for Q&A, but if you want to chat more about this, you can find us at United Cloud booth on second floor. Thank you.